You're listening to TehachaPod with Key Budge, Corey Costello, and Greg Garrett.
It's TehachaPod time again. Corey Costello joins me today. I'm Key Budge. Corey, how are you?
I'm doing well.
You just got out of a meeting. You've got Assemblyman Vince Fong that you brought into the studio to have a podcast with us again today.
You know, he knew he was coming to Tehachapi, and he like was begging me, can I get on TehachaPod?
This is the place to be.
I know where to get to reach my constituents, and it's TehachaPod. So
that's
I said,
right.
Fine.
Welcome back to TehachaPod.
I'm excited to be here.
It's good to have you in person because we've had you via Zoom a couple times. And so thank you for coming.
It's feeling a little more normal.
Yes. Thank you for coming to Tehachapi. We appreciate that. I know you have a full day of stuff up here. And it's good to have you in person in the studio on the show.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Yeah, we had you in April of 2020.
Time stood still.
It was. And that pandemic was one of those things that we were talking to you, what's going on with the state? How do we, you know, we're reacting. And that was one of our Zoom, you know, calls that we had.
That's right.
And
it was,
and we were all in a different spot. I think you were in your place in Sacramento working from home. You know, you were in your house. Yeah. I was in my house. I think Greg was in City Hall. Like we were, none of us were in the same spot during that show. It's crazy.
Yeah. It's such a different time. And then you also provided messages for some of our special shows dealing with the military veterans. So let me say thank you for that.
Oh, thank you for what you guys are doing.
One of those was our award-winning show, too. Yeah. I don't know if we let you know, but that was our salute to freedom. Mm-hmm. And you provided a special shout-out to our military. So thank you.
We can't thank them enough.
Exactly. I feel the same way. So there's not much to talk about here in California. You know, it's kind of a
especially for a Republican lawmaker, and not much going on.
There's a lot going on, that's for sure.
Where do we want to start? Do you want to start with what's going on with the budget?
Well, the budget is the most important document that we produce in the state because it allocates all the resources for programs that affect everyday Californians. You know, this budget process has been unlike any other, the most chaotic I've seen since I've been elected, in part because there's now this excess federal money that's come from Congress. You have additional state revenue that's come in. So what they would call a surplus has materialized. And now we're trying to figure out what the best use of those funds are. I would argue that we need to be investing in water storage now that we're trying to deal with this drought that we're in. Wildfire season never ends. And so we need to focus on that. We've got a lot of state agencies that have just not performed very well during this pandemic, the EDD being the obvious one, with a million Californians still on backlog trying to get their benefits. So the pandemic has kind of revealed a lot of structural mismanagement, I think, within the state government. I think everyone kind of is not surprised by that. But now we have to figure out how to fix them, all those things. So we have to get back to the basics. And I think that we're having this really intense debate and fight over what we should be investing in and what we should be doing as a state. And I think that's a never-ending process right now. We've gone through four versions of a budget, and we're trying to do the right thing. But a lot of times people don't pay attention to what's going on in Sacramento until after the fact. And I think the unfortunate byproduct of what's happening right now is that because this budget process is so rushed, there's very little public input. And that's one of my biggest frustrations, concern, is the lack of transparency. Because I think the public needs to be part of that process to understand what's happening.
It's amazing. You know, when you look at the news, you get 30 seconds of coverage on a topic like this, and it's hard for the individuals to inform themselves just if they work on traditional news without taking a deeper dive. And I think that's part of the reason why we started this podcast was to take a deeper dive into these conversations.
And that's why this podcast is so important. It's hard to talk about, I mean, you could do a topic, a whole podcast on wildfire prevention or on water, which we talked about, and what Tehachapi is doing to prepare for the next drought and trying to be forward looking. Broadband, trying to get communities connected to the internet. I mean, you could do a whole, you could do five podcasts on that topic.
Right. With the budget in mind, and we're reaching out to the greater Tehachapi area, where do we want to send them to follow along, to take that deeper dive, to dig in and educate themselves on this process that's going on in Sacramento that is going to impact all of us?
Well, the budget committee that I'm the vice chair of, we have resources that we're trying to get out there. The Department of Finance is the governor's arm of the budget. The Legislative Analyst Office is kind of the independent arbiter of analysis. So those are kind of the resources I think the public could engage in and review those topics. But of course, we want the public to interact with us. We are always looking for solutions and ideas in terms of how best to deliver services. You guys have led the charge in, you know, providing customer service as a local government. We're trying to infuse that mentality into state government. There's no doubt that a lot of your listeners have problems with the DMV, EDD for sure, any state agency that any California is interacting with. How can we best improve what they're doing? And I think that's something that we're trying to focus on, is that we have a lot of broken systems, a lot of mismanagement. So when we're debating putting precious tax dollars, millions of dollars, or even billions of dollars into those systems, well, we got to fix the system first. Pouring billions of dollars into a broken system without fixing the foundation just is a recipe for disaster. And so that's what we're trying to get folks to focus on, is like, let's pump the brakes a little bit. Let's do an analysis. We don't have to spend all the money all at once. Let's build up our reserves, save that money for a rainy day, look at the systems that we have to fix and fix them before just trying to push out, you know, money where maybe there's not the capacity to do it.
You brought up a couple things with the, especially when it deals with the budget. And I know you made some comments recently about water storage, since we are in a drought and we maybe waited too long to kind of address that. And then even the wildfire prevention, knowing that we'd have a wildfire season. So what are some of the things you're looking at, especially when it comes to, you know, water delivery of state water, project water throughout the Central Valley, and then ultimately up to Tehachapi a little bit as well. So what are some of those things and ideas you're possibly working on?
Well, my biggest fear is that we're going to miss another window to actually solve these problems for the long term. Mm-hmm. So many of your listeners probably remember that we had a water bond years ago that was supposed to build water storage in our state to prepare for the next drought. And we are now in this new drought season and we didn't build any water storage.
Built a lot of parks with it though, which
That's
is
right. And so where did that money go and why didn't it happen? And so any solution right now to our water situation and our long-term health as a state preparing for the next drought has to include water storage. You guys in the city of Tehachapi are planning to build infrastructure to allow you guys to have water in the long run. And that's important. Every community needs to be to focus on that. But so as we debate the budget and part of the work we're going to do in the next 4 weeks is to flesh out, all right, we have all this one-time funds. Let's see where we can put those monies into shovel-ready projects, into water storage, conveyance facilities, moving water around the state, because that's what's critical. Wildfires and wildfire prevention, extremely critical. We've got probably 12, 13 fires that are burning right now. They're getting larger in size. We knew that this was going to be a problem. We've got 150 million dead and dying trees in our forest right now. And of course, that tied to power shutoffs. Mm-hmm. And when wildfires break out, you know, we have the utilities are under a tremendous amount of stress. So everything compounds it. I mean, everything's tied to each other. And then the drought makes it worse because everything is drier. So we should have been more proactive. When it comes to wildfire prevention, we need to be investing a ongoing sustainable amount of funding to actually and partner with local communities to, because you guys know where the fire break should be. You guys know what needs to be done in terms of removing the fuels. So let's partner with the cities and the counties and the nonprofits and the fire safe councils, give them the resources on an ongoing basis, right? Because we're not going to solve this problem in 1 year. We got 10 or 15 years of work that we need to do. So it has to be sustainable funding, and we have to make it, we have to streamline the process. You can't do 2 years of environmental review to try to get these fire breaks done. The tragic stories, I mean, I've gone and visited Paradise. That was a community completely devastated by the campfire. You have the most recent wildfire last year in Shaver Lake. There was a fire break planned and it never got done. And that fire wiped that whole area where that fire break was supposed to be. So we can't be caught flat-footed. We have to be proactive when it comes to that.
You brought up something that's kind of near and dear. I live in Bear Valley. So Bear Valley is, you know, when I moved in there 20 years ago, they talked about all these fire emergency access points that you could exit the valley. And none of those are available because of the overgrown. They haven't been maintained. They're at a point that it wouldn't be safe for the public to try and exit in a fire. But it's the conversation, it seems to always be the same. When I hear it from the local resident side, and that's who I'm representing right now as I speak, is you hear the conversation about, hey, we've got these four different access points to exit, but they're not available to us. And then, so the fire department comes in and does its plan, and the police department comes in and does a plan, but all it is a discussion of, the roads aren't available. Yeah. It doesn't go beyond that.
And that's why we need to be partnering with communities to try to provide those those needed resources to get those projects done. I mean, it's critical. Lives and livelihoods on the line. When I started my career, the Erskine fire was right. The fire in the Kern River Valley. At that time, that was considered a big fire. And then following maybe a number of years later, the Camp Fire came in. Paradise had two points of entry and exit. And you had residents trapped in an area that they couldn't get out. I mean, 85 people died during that fire. The community was completely devastated. When I visited, I stood at a school with the members of the community and the legislators there and with the governor. And that school was saved because all around that school was a forested area and they did vegetation management to the point where that school was saved. Right across the street, completely devastated. And so we know what we need to do. We just need the funding. We need on a sustainable basis. We need the political will. And we need to streamline the process to get these projects done as quickly as possible.
I think the political will is a big one because, you know, you talk about, you know, things like, even though it's a federal deal, you know, Bureau of Land Management, it's supposed to be a land manager, not just a land protector. And I think that happens a lot where proper forest management, proper wildfire management, or wildlife management, this all happens with appropriate logging, appropriate hunting practices, those sorts of things. I think that gets lost because people, oh no, it's nature, we shouldn't touch it. But that's exactly the opposite. When we live amongst nature in communities like Tehachapi and even throughout the state, in even more sort of wooded areas, wildland areas, we have to manage that. We are a part of it. And I think that there's this sort of, we don't want to touch it because it's an environmental issue.
That collaborative process with the federal government, the federal lands, then you have the state lands. And then, of course, you have fires that are occurring in urban centers.
Yeah.
You know, so yes, right now we are in catch-up mode. Mm-hmm. I mean, we right now, the reality of our forest is that there are hundreds of millions of dead trees, fuels ready. I mean, with a lightning strike or a car sparking something on the road, that could be hundreds of thousands of acres. And so that's something that we have to take seriously, and we have to do it now. I mean, we're already behind. And so those are the two biggest issues, I think, as we move forward in the budget process that we're going to have to get right. And I hope we do, because we can't afford missing this opportunity.
You had a couple legislative wins recently, that things that you were really championing. AB 398 was the most recent. That was a DMV bill that does not allow DMV to sell driver information. And then AB 3, which is illegal street racing sideshows, which I know was a problem in some of the larger cities you represent. So talk about those two real quick and what they mean.
Well, as someone who, when I got elected and when I was put on the transportation committee and became the vice chair, the DMV was probably the one topic that everyone talked to me the most. I think every constituent probably has a story of how the DMV can improve. A number of constituents actually called me and said, "Hey, can the DMV sell my information? You know, if I provide my driver's license or personal information?" And we did some research on it because they were really concerned about the privacy of what they're providing. And it comes to find out that in the code, it actually potentially allowed the DMV to sell information for profit. And that would be unacceptable. And so I partnered with the chair of the privacy committee, and we went through the entire vehicle code, and we eliminated all the sections that would potentially allow the DMV to actually profit off of someone's information that they're providing the government. So that bill was flew through the Assembly and the State Senate, was signed into law by the governor last week. So really excited about that. You know, street racing and sideshows, that's a growing issue since the pandemic. AB3 was a response to that. If you go to any community now, it feels, and you talk to law enforcement, it's like it's out of control. You know, you've got freeways and roads being taken over on the evenings. During the pandemic, when everyone was not on the road, I think, you know, a lot of folks kind of took advantage of the situation. But this, according to CHP, they've seen a 300% increase this year in terms of citations for the exhibition of speed. So we're trying to wrap our hands around how do you deal with these sideshows, these parking lots being taken over, these intersections being taken over that are putting not only drivers but pedestrians at risk. The stories from families that have lost young people, their young ones, because they're just a spectator and the car loses control and goes in and kills somebody. So what we're trying to do is, if you're cited for street racing, you can have your driver's license suspended up to 6 months. But if you're cited for and convicted for the exhibition of speed or a sideshow, that penalty isn't there, which is kind of interesting. So what we do is we treat them the same. if you are convicted of participating in a sideshow, then you have the potential of getting your driver's license suspended. Looking at the data, it's very effective in actually reducing recidivism. If you get your license suspended, that's a serious consequence.
What is actually a sideshow? Because I'm not really familiar with that term. The street racing aspect, yeah. Is this more where they're in the parking lots and they're doing the Fast and Furious, the drifting, and they're
so that kind of thing? Fast and Furious is probably the one example that a lot of people understand of what a sideshow is. So yeah, it's basically a group of individuals that gather together and they're basically accelerating or using their car to show off to a crowd.
Okay.
This will be the first time a sideshow is defined in statute. If you look at the code right now, the vehicle code, sideshow is not something that is defined. Law enforcement has defined it, but it is not in the law. And so, what law enforcement is looking for is we need help, we need assistance. Because sometimes you can't. Key, you were in law enforcement. Yeah. Sometimes you're not going to catch someone driving along the racing another car along the road.
Right.
But you may be able to catch somebody before they street race at a sideshow. So a sideshow is basically two or more cars performing stunts in an unsafe manner.
Okay.
For a crowd.
And I know that there's some help and there's some areas in Bakersfield, Central Valley specifically, a lot of this before COVID, but they brought some of them back. You know, I know Kern County Raceway Park will host drag nights and streetcars and Famoso Raceway as well has these opportunities to legally go and have these events. That way you're not in a parking lot and it's safe and it's monitored and you can go and do whatever you
want. And that's what we're trying to do. We're also trying to partner. I mean, we're not all about just, I mean, we have to crack down on this illegal behavior because it's making our roadways unsafe, but we also want to provide an outlet for those who want to drift or to race in a safe way. So partnering with the raceways and the racetracks and providing those opportunities, that's something that we want to do as well.
Gas is like $4.50 a gallon. Why would you rev your engine right now? I'm just saying, just trying to be a little prudent here.
You can replace your tires and, you know.
Yeah, and tires are expensive. You burn them up.
A lot of these folks are putting a lot of money in these cars, and they're amazing vehicles.
Yeah.
We just want them to use them in a safe way.
But then the trickle down from that, there's so many stolen cars, stolen parts that play into some of those scenarios of that kind of exhibition is these participants are into, you know, the auto theft. So, I mean, it's more than just that event. It's a ripple effect across.
It's one of those situations. Yeah. If you talk to law enforcement, this is one of the biggest growing activities that's happening when they have to divert resources to chasing someone along the street or going on a high speed chase. I mean, they want to be focusing on robberies and aggravated crimes and just keeping the neighborhood safe. They don't want to be diverting their attention to these activities.
Right. They're a loud party. Yeah. They are this out of control, I don't want to call it a frat party, but that Friday night gathering of high school and young college age that just get out of control
doing it in the daytime now. So I've talked to families who a tragic story where they were sitting at a red light in the middle of Southwest Bakersfield and a car comes, they're racing each other and a woman's mom dies in a street racing accident and she's just parked at the red light. Yeah. I mean, this is behavior that is unacceptable.
I used to live off of Old River Road, and Old River in Bakersfield was, I mean, I could hear it from my house, but I'd be driving on Old River and all of a sudden, like, I'm in the way as they're weaving in and out because there's two souped up whatevers that are having a late night race, you know, on Old River Road.
There are a lot of people caught in street races. Just weren't expecting it. Driving along the Westside Parkway, driving down White Lane, Gosford, going on the 14, you know, and they're just like, it's quite an experience.
It gives more tools for law enforcement to help provide public safety.
So that bill has gone through the appropriations committee. It's going to, gone through like the gauntlet. It's gone through so many committees. We have one more committee to go through. We have to get through the appropriations committee. Then if it passes out of the appropriations committee, then it should pass overwhelmingly through the Senate and the Assembly. And hopefully we can get to the governor's for his signature.
Wow.
Awesome. Well, I know you've got a bunch of other things to get to today, so we don't want to hold you too long, but people can find you on Twitter at ASM Vince Fong, Facebook, ASSM Vince Fong on the Facebook page. You can search him and find him there. And then obviously the phone number is for
you. Absolutely. And I'm on Instagram too. Vince Fong 661.
Yeah. Perfect.
Is there anything else that you want to bring up before I know you've got to go because you've got another speaking engagement, but is there anything else that you'd like to bring up to the audience?
I think it's just my big message to the community is just to stay engaged. There's so much going on, whether it's housing, whether it's public safety, whether it's water, whether it's wildfire prevention, all these, we're going to probably hopefully have a solution to the PSPS problem, mm-hmm. and avoid these power shutoffs that are happening. But we need the public to engage. I remembered the last PSPS event over Christmas Eve. I was talking to constituents on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, and they're shocked that they're hearing from me. But at the same time, these are important issues, and we just can't allow them to reoccur. And these problems are getting larger and larger, and so we like to hear from them, and it's important for the public to stay engaged.
One of our recent shows, we had Southern California Edison, the director of expedited grid hardening, on to talk about the grid hardening efforts mm-hmm. here in Tehachapi. And we fielded questions from the community. And I think we got some good answers, yeah. And their work is, you know.
And the community has some great solutions. I mean, we don't have all the answers, and a lot of times we hear different perspectives, and the good ideas are good ideas.
And we've given Edison a ton of credit. I mean, you cannot not see the crews, the contractors they've had here for the last 2 years in the Tehachapi area, updating our grid and hardening our grid. And, it's definitely made a difference. And we'll hopefully these events will be, fewer and far between. That's but they had to do a lot of work in order to make it that a possibility.
But I know that's a lot of thanks to you, Senator Grove, who put pressure on them and wanted answers to questions mm-hmm. when this took place 2 years ago. So thank you for representing us that way, because I do know that you guys were making those calls, because we got the calls from Edison saying, how are you able to get them to call us on a constant basis and put that, and let us know they're
not happy?
Because
I just sent them a text about how mad I am. That's why.
But those are important. I mean, we know what we know. And so when problems arise in the community, I mean, that's why, I mean, we are advocates for the community. And so feel free. I mean, I try to pride myself in my accessibility to those that I'm proud to represent. And so if there's anything that I could be helpful on, call, text, write, reach out to us on social media. That's really important.
Well, we just want to say thank you for joining us today here in Tehachapi. This is TehachaPod, and we appreciate the conversation. We covered a lot of grounds. We did it quick, but we appreciate the fact that you take the time to come up and visit us and are willing to sit down and talk.
Absolutely. Look forward to the next time.
Yeah, absolutely. Great.
So this is TehachaPod. We're going to say thank you to Assemblyman Vince Fong, representing the 34th District here in California, which includes Tehachapi and our surrounding communities. And if you ever have a question that you'd like us maybe to send to Assemblyman Fong, we'll do that. Or if you've got another show topic, send us an email, media@TehachapiCityHall.com. We appreciate your time, and we look forward to talking to you again soon.
TehachaPod is a conversation about Tehachapi designed for the people who live here or who would like to know more about this mountaintop community. If you have a question you would like answered, email media@TehachapiCityHall.com. We will try to answer it on a future episode of TehachaPod.